All right. If the kids want to go back with Harold, he'll take you back to kids' church. Everyone have a good week? Yeah. Should have a good week. You had Jesus in your heart, right? Even in those hard times, we should have a good time. So we've a couple announcements. We've got, one in particular. We're going to start with a blessing box, and we're going to put it out front, but we need to build it first. So I'm going to open it up to anyone that wants to help build the blessing box. That way we can bless this community. There's only one other one in town, and it's on Main Street, wherever that is. I'm sure everyone else knows, but I don't. But there's none on this side of the town, and we're working with Pantries Plus. So as soon as we get it built, Pantries Plus will come out once a week and stock it, or as needed, and check on it. So that could we could be a blessing to the kids and the families around here that can't get food when they need it. So if anyone wants to help with that, get with me, and we will make it happen. So we've been in Acts for a minute, right? And we saw how boldly Peter spoke and how they are willing to step out in faith and be obedient to what God has called them to do. And last week, we talked about how Paul and Barnabas and others planted churches to make disciples. They continued to share the love of Jesus by loving on others and bringing them up in the ways of the Lord. That's what we're called to, church. We're called to share Jesus' love, to bring them up in the teachings of God. Right? We see Paul go on two more ministry journeys in the book of Acts, where he's doing the same thing, where he planted a church, where he made disciples, and he brought people up, and he taught them, he made leaders, and brought them up. I'm trying not to talk too fast. I had a big, large cup of coffee and a Red Bull right before this, so I'm like, I'm a little amped right now. I'm telling you, my heart's going 1,000 miles an hour, and it ain't cause of nervous, it's just, I could run laps right now, so I'm trying to calm it down a little bit. So today, I want to look at, we're going to be in Acts chapter 20, and we're going to see Paul's farewell to the elders of the Ephesian church. This was at the end of his third ministerial journey. He tells them that he has shared the good news and truth with Jews and Greeks, and now God is leading him elsewhere. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your love and the opportunities that you have created for us to share you, to teach people of your love, your character, hope, joy, peace that only is found in you. We thank you for those times. We thank you for the opportunity that we live in a country where we can gather together to learn more about you so that we can go out later through the week and share what we've learned so that we may be inspired to learn more and dig in it on our own. I thank you for each person that's here, and I pray for the ones that are not here, Lord, that you would just bless them and watch over them today. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to start off in Acts 20, verses 22 through 24. So if you have your Bibles, you can open them or your phone. It says, "And now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardship are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task to testify to the good news of God's grace." See, Paul was being led by the Spirit to go to Jerusalem, knowing that he was probably going to go through hardships, knowing that he was going to go to prison. Paul knew this because God revealed it to him and prepared him for this. How would you react to that? If God said, I want you to go do something, but I'm telling you it's going to be hard. I'm telling you there's going to be hardship in this. It's not going to be easy. You might get in, you might go to prison. You might find someone that stands up in front of you and discredits what you have. How would you react? Would you be like Paul and say, yes, I'm obedient. I'll go where you lead me. A lot of times we see people that fear of those hardships, knowing that it's not going to be easy. We kind of put it off. And I say that because I was that way. When I was first called to go into the nursing homes, I had the same fear. I don't know enough. I don't know anything about the Bible. I don't know anything about God. I don't even know God yet. Why would you want me to go here? I don't even know what you're saying to me. And I put it off and I put it off. I even put it off after I got saved and went into another ministry, even though God was still calling me to the nursing home. See, Paul didn't say no to God. He was obedient. He didn't question where God was leading him. He trusted God. He was obedient to God and the mission God had given him. See, when we have a calling on our lives from God, it's like nothing you've ever felt. When you have that calling and you know that's where you're supposed to be, where God has placed you, the passion inside of you just pours out. I've seen it time and time again with people that they come into a ministry, and anything can be a ministry. If you are loving on others and you're sharing the gospel, you see that passion flow out of them. You see the love that Jesus filled in with them pour out to them. There's a feeling of just joy, happiness, knowing this is where you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to do. You don't want to do anything else. There's a lot of times, and you've heard me say this before, that there's tons of needs. There's always needs in our communities and people's lives. There's always needs. We can't fill every need. But each one of us is being called to something, right, according to our gifts. We don't want to just fill a hole, just to fill a hole, because then we're keeping someone from their calling. Because most people will say, well, that they don't need me, because they let that fear sink in of the hardships. And they'll say, well, that's already filled. They don't need me there. So we have to make sure that we are aware where God is calling us to be. See, when you answer God's call, when you're obedient to God, your actions will show that, and your passion will be a witness to others. And that's part of our mission, right? To share the good news and be witnesses to the ends of the world. When we serve where we're supposed to, where we're called, that passion shows. Your actions show. Your faith and your actions, they come together and they show people what the faith in Jesus is, and your actions are showing what it is to be Christ-like. That's why we can't just fill holes. We need to go where God is calling us to go, because if we're not called to it, then that passion's not there. Right? We're just filling a need. We're just running through the steps like we should. Pray about where God wants you. Get into his word and find out where he wants you. He will speak back to you. Me and Connor were talking about this yesterday. We were doing a Bible study, and he's like, I read the Bible and I don't hear God. And I had to explain to him that when we read and we quiet ourselves and we focus on Jesus, he will speak to you. He'll reveal himself to you. He'll show you where you're supposed to be, where you're going to find happiness, where you're going to prosper, and where he's going to place you is going to be exactly where you want to be, whether you know it or not at that time. See, when we're where we're supposed to be, where we're in that God's calling, and we're doing his will, you won't regret it, even in those hard times. And there's hard times in ministry. No matter what ministry in, there is hard times. There's times where you're just sitting there thinking, I don't know if I want to do this anymore, and then God reminds you. Carolyn reminded me of something today, and I didn't even think about it until she said it, but write down your blessings. So when them hard times come, you can go back to them and see how God has blessed you and how he has blessed what he has called you to do. Amen. See, I keep a prayer journal. I encourage my kids to keep a prayer journal. I encourage everyone to keep a prayer journal. That way you can go back and you can see how God has moved, how he has worked. And if I go back to a year ago, man, he has moved mountains in my life. And I bet if you think hard enough, he's moved mountains in your life. I'm sure that when he told the elders that he was going on and he knew he was going to go through hardship and probably be in prison, I'm sure it didn't make sense to them, because in their mind, they're probably thinking, just stay here with us where you're safe and where you can teach us. It doesn't make sense to a lot of people when God says go. Maybe financially it doesn't make sense. Maybe time-wise it doesn't make sense. But I do know if you're in God's will, he'll give you the time. He'll provide the finances. He'll provide everything you need to do that calling. I'm sure it didn't make sense to Paul either, but he was willing. He knew that God's plan was perfect. And he was to the mission, obedient to the mission of planting seeds and knowing that salvation is for everyone. See, we have to be obedient. We have to be willing to go when it doesn't make sense. Because that's when we see God move. We see him working. That's when we grow closer to him. Amazing things will happen. God's plans are perfect. We can't doubt his plans. He knew what happened yesterday. He knows what happened today. He knows what's going to happen tomorrow. He knows the hardships that you're going to go through, the good times, who you're going to reach, seeds that you're going to plant. Paul had many examples of this in his testimony. If you go back and look through from the time of his salvation to now, that's what he was sharing. He was sharing the good news, but he was sharing his testimonies of how God had moved through his life and moved through others and the Gentiles and all God had done. He was standing on God's promises. So how do we know God's promises? All right, we're not going to know his promises unless we get into his word. You don't know God's character unless you get in his word. I don't want you to just take what I say and go with it. I want you to hear what I say, go home, and study it for yourself. I want you to see God face to face. Because when you do that, you start growing that personal relationship with Jesus. You have to open your Bibles. You have to get into God's character, get into his word, and he'll reveal himself. Then you will see that he is always with you, that he loves you, that he wants the best for you. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, it says, "Let us hold unwavering to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful." So like I said, if we look back in our lives, we can see how God moved and how he worked in our lives, how he protected us from things, how he provided for us in those hard times, maybe financially, maybe time-wise, maybe you had a car accident and God protected you. He's always with you no matter what. If you don't know God's character and his promises, and you're struggling to see him move, pray. Pray and seek God. Open those Bibles. Pray earnestly. Because we know that when we seek him, we find him. When you find him, you'll know there's no other love. There's no other hope. There's no other peace. And I'm not talking about peace like war, there's peace. I'm talking about there's just peace in your spirit, just calmness in the midst of a storm. That you're not worried, that you know he's got it, he's in control. See, when we go through hard times, and we know that we're going to go through suffering, God doesn't promise that we're not going to suffer. He promises that he'll be there with us through those hard times. But when life gives those suffering, and we know that we're going to suffer because we live in a broken world that is full of sin, and it won't be made right again until when Jesus comes back, where there is no more suffering, or we're called home. So storms are going to come. Whether you're in one now or it comes later, you're going to go through a storm. In ministry, you'll go through storms and heartache and hardships and everything in life. But when you get into God's word and you get in prayer and you seek him and you see his character and how faithful he is in your life, you can just sit in the middle with Jesus in the eye of the storm and watch it unfold. You could see him working in that storm. And like I've said before, don't pray. We shouldn't be praying out of those storms. That's our number one response, right? When a storm comes, God, take me out of it right now. I don't want nothing to do with it. But we should be praying, God, what do I need to learn from this storm? How can I grow closer to you in this storm? Who can I reach during this time? How are you going to use this storm to reach someone else? That's what we should be praying. Not, God, take me out of it. But how are you going to use it? In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 10 through 11, it says, "And the God of all grace who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen." See, we live a temporary life, a short life. And before we know it, Jesus is going to return, or we're going to be called home. We have just a little time on this earth to share the love of Jesus, to be his hands and feet. We have to be willing to suffer for Christ as he suffered for us so that we could live. Paul, it's an amazing example of how we should be glad and willing to suffer for Christ. Because don't forget, Jesus went to the cross for you. This is where you make it personal. He went to the cross for you. He was whipped, beaten, spit on, mocked. He went to the cross with nails in his arms, hung there, and died for you. So that you may live. And the suffering that we go through is nothing like that. See, but we have hope. Because on that third day, that tomb was empty. See, the world today tells us that life is only good if we get something back from our serving. That unless we are getting recognition, money, success, that we don't have a good life. See, the world's telling us that we have to have those things to have a good life. Paul says that his life is nothing unless I am being used by God to do his work. We are called to have a servant's heart. We are called to serve. To humble ourselves and to serve others and to give God the glory when we do, expecting nothing in return. Because our treasure is Jesus. And one day we'll get to live with him forever, praising and worshiping him. See, being a servant, we're going to look at a few different things. Number one, Jesus is our example of having a servant's heart. He was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. But during the Last Supper, he humbled himself. He took off his cloak, he wrapped a towel around him, and he washed the disciples' feet. He humbled himself. This is God in human form, washing feet. He was the perfect example of a servant's heart. And we see that in John 13. Number two, if we want to be great, we have to be last. And you can find that in Matthew chapter 20, verse 26. And I'm not going to read that to you because I want you to look it up. Number three, we show love for God by loving on others. That can be hard to do, right? Because some people, it is painfully hard to love. Some people, it just get underneath your skin and it's Satan comes attacking. It's hard to love on some people, but we show love for God by loving on others. Number four, we have to consider others before ourselves. I think that's hard too, because the world's also teaching us and brought most of us up in that way. That you have to do things for yourself, and if you don't focus on yourself, you're not going to get anywhere. Jesus was the complete opposite of that. And number five, use the gifts God has given you to serve others. Each one of you has a gift from God. When we first started, I give you a spiritual test. If you want another one, I have plenty. We have to be willing and obedient to say to go when he says go, and to serve where he wants us to serve, and to use those gifts that he has given us to be his hands and feet. What Paul put into life was much greater than what he got out of it. He didn't want recognition. He didn't want money. He didn't want fame. That thing sounds weird. Everyone on this side, just be prepared. I don't know what's going to happen. But Paul humbled himself and said, I'm going to glorify Jesus in this moment. Of everything I do, God's going to get the glory. He had a servant's heart. Paul was focused on one thing, and that was serving God and the mission God had given him. Paul had his eyes on Jesus. Remember, if we go back to Peter stepping out onto the water, walking to Jesus, he had his eyes on Jesus. He was doing great walking on that water. And the moment he took his eyes off, he sunk. We have to be focused on Jesus. What is more important to you? To serve and love on others humbly? Or to get recognition for that serving? Paul was saying to all the Ephesian elders, God is telling us to build up leaders, to build the church. See, this building, it's just a building with walls, a place for us to gather and to use. Now, don't get me wrong. God has given us this amazing facility to be able to serve, to open up our doors to our communities and let them come in and be loved on. But we are the church. Those things can't happen unless we are willing to step up and say, I feel like God's leading me here, and I want to do this. Don't wait for someone else to step up and do it, because they have their own calling. If God's calling you, if he's got something on your heart saying, you need to do this, step up. Say, God, I'm willing. Provide the way. We have to bring up leaders in our church so that they can build up leaders, so that the church will grow, not just in numbers here, but across the world. That's the great thing about the Nazarene denomination, is that we're constantly building up leaders, and they're going overseas, and they're witnessing to people that have never heard the gospel before in their lives, putting their lives on the line in countries that some, it's illegal to be a Christian, willing to go to prison. If they're willing to do that, shouldn't we be willing to do it here? Because the most we're giving up is a little bit of time. Some time to love on people. That's time well spent. He's also telling them that they have to be on guard. Now, he's telling them to be on guard because the closer you get to God, the more the enemy attacks, the more he's going to send those hardships. We have to be on guard, and we have to be ready, putting on our armor and being ready to face whatever the enemy comes at us with. We fight him off with God's word and prayer. Now, if we go to verse 31 in Acts 20, it says, "So be on your guard. Remember, for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you, night and day, with tears." Do you see the relationship that they had? I mean, if you really open up these passages and you read how Paul and these elders are interacting with each other, do you see the relationship that they built? It's showing us an example of fellowship. We have to fellowship. The word fellowship is used 20 times in the New Testament. Fellowship builds unity. The church is called to be united. Unity is having everything in common and being of the same mind. We should all have one goal, and that is to glorify God by making Christ-like disciples, by growing closer to God in our relationships. In turn, when we do that together, we grow in our relationship together. We'll have that relationship like Paul had with these elders. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6, it says, "Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." It is important for us to fellowship. It is important for us to gather together, grow with each other. Anytime that you're with someone, a brother or sister, and you're talking about God, that is fellowship. When you do that, that's so we can be more unified. See, Paul and the Ephesian elders had prayed, they served, they cared for each other. They built a relationship that could never be lost, never forgotten. They built a bond They were their core circle. Who do you go to when you're struggling with something and you need prayer? Who do you go to when you need encouragement? Who is in your core circle? If you don't have someone, step out in faith. Have God direct you to some people, because it is so important to have those relationships in the church. We're a family. We're a church family. Through Christ, we are brothers and sisters. We are to be there for one another. Just like the song said, when you fall, I fall. When you rise, I'll rise. Lift each other up. Be there in those hard times. As we do these things, our relationships will grow. But we can't do this. We can't have relationships unless we let people into our lives, unless we open up and we invest in their lives. You have to be willing to invest, and you have to be willing to let people in. In verse 32 of Acts 20, it says, "Now I commit you to God, to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Paul taught them to love as Jesus did. He is saying, go, let God work through you. Paul tells them, God is your guide. He will direct you exactly where he wants you. So this is going back to this calling. See, Paul has built them up. He's taught them. He's invested in them. He has built this relationship. Now it's time for him to say, go. Go out into the world and share what God has done. Let God guide you and direct you where he is calling you to be. The same thing is for the church today. I can't do everything, nor do I want to do everything. It takes all of us. My goal here is that we gather and that we grow together. So you will go and you will serve and you will reach people for Jesus. God will make your path straight. He will direct you exactly where he wants you, and he will provide everything you need. Now, if we go to verse 33, he says, I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. Are you coveting anything in your life? Are you holding on to it so tight that you can't let God have control of that? Or I'm sorry, he says, content. I'm sorry. Are you content with everything in life? Are you content with what God has given you? Or are you lusting after the new thing, the best thing, more money? Are you lusting after more money? Are you lusting after a new house? Are you lusting after a new car? Paul was happy with what he had as long as he could do God's work. That's what he cared about. He wasn't a rich man. He was rich in faith and just wanted to do God's will. See, there's many times in our life our attitudes are wrong because we're not happy or content with what God has given us. We lust after newer things, but we have to remember that these things are temporary. That money is temporary, that your house is temporary. Because when God calls us home or he comes back, they're not going to be there. We can't take them with us. But Jesus is forever. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Like God, like Paul, let's make God the priority in our life. God should be number one. above all. That means above your kids, above your spouse. He should be the number one. Your first relationship, it should be up and down. And if your relationship is up and down and your spouse's relationship is up and down, then guess what? You guys are going to have a good relationship. Your spouse should be second, and then your kids, then everything else follows. But for all those relationships to be in sync, you have to seek God first. Make time for Him. Build that relationship. Now, if we jump down to verse 34 in Acts 20, it says, "You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions." See, Paul was a tent maker. He worked when he had to, when he needed money. He worked to support himself, but he also worked to supply his friends that were on the mission with him. He worked so he could do God's work. He didn't do it to get rich. He worked for God. God provided opportunities for Paul to work. He provided these people that needed tents. And I'm not talking about like a, you know, little Ozark tent that you put in your backyard. These things were massive. See, Paul does, or God does the same for us. Everything we have, our job, finances, everything we have is because of God. Because God has given it to you. He has blessed you with it. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 23, it says, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not human masters." How many of you like going to work? No one's raising their hand, so I'm going to say no. See, when we work, and we all have to work to live, right? When we work, don't do it for your boss. Don't do it for your company. Do it as if God Himself asked you to do it. You give 110% at your job or whatever you do. When you do that, you're being a witness. Right? When we give all we have, and God has given you your job, He has given you this opportunity, and He is going to use you in that place, whatever you do, we can be witnesses there. Part of our mission is to be Jesus' witness. And this is just one part of it. Now, if we go down to verse 35, it says, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remembering the words of our Lord Jesus Himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.'" Now, this passage, "It is more blessed to give than to receive," that is not in the gospel. It'll be highlighted red in your Bible because Jesus spoke it. But as I was researching it, a lot of theologians, scholars, they believe that this was by word of mouth, that Jesus spoke it to the apostles and they passed it down by word of mouth, which is not uncommon because most of Scripture is passed down by word of mouth. The older generation was revealed or brought up. They were somewhat of importance because they would pass down what God had done. They would share with the younger generation. So this passage was brought down by word of mouth. It says, it's such a blessing to give to others. See, when we give, we know that we're going to be rewarded. Might not be right away, but God's going to reward your giving. One of the ways that we give, and I told you, you won't hear me talk about this much, is tithing. When you tithe to a church, and it doesn't matter if you tithe to this church or another church, God's going to bless that. See, we use the tithing here to reach people. because it is on my heart to reach everyone. I don't want to picture a place that I can't plant a seed. I want to make sure that I create opportunities for people to come to know Jesus Christ. So when you tithe here, that is what it's going for, so that we can use this facility to reach this community and the communities around it. But with tithing, so if you look at tithing, we know that the money we give here is to further God's kingdom. But did you know there is one place in the Bible that God says, test me? See, if you read in Matthew, when Satan's tempting Jesus, Jesus comes back at Satan and says, do not test God. But it says in one place in Scripture, test me. And that's with your finances. It's in Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. When you tithe, it's between you and God. I'm not going to tell you how much to tithe. I don't want to know how much you tithe. I don't care how much you tithe. That is between you and God. Whatever God lays on your heart, that's what I want you to do. No matter what, you will see a blessing from it. If you trust God with your finances, He will reward it. Test Him in this. He tells you to test Him. See what He'll do. He'll open the floodgates. See, we did this, I don't even know how many years ago. And we didn't, at that time, we didn't make nothing. Hardly nothing. I don't even think we lived paycheck to paycheck. It was worse than that. We started tithing regularly, 10% every single week, no matter what. When I got paid, first thing we did, 10%, straight out, before we paid any bills, before we paid, bought food, anything. We paid our tithes. And I'm telling you right now, I'm a witness. Our family is a witness that God will bless those who give. He has blessed our family beyond what we ever imagined. Amen. You can ask Jennifer. It has been amazing to see how God has blessed our finances. And it all stemmed from a sermon that we listened to from Charles Stanley on testing Him in this. Trusting God with our finances. It is amazing to watch what He does. When you trust God in this, He does open those floodgates. There's been many times that He has called us to do something, even after our tithe, to buy extra for the nursing homes, or, you know, not knowing how we were going to afford it, spending $80, $100 a week on snacks for the nursing homes, and where we don't even have the money to do it, and God somehow always repaid us double. It's been amazing. See, I know when I tithe that my money is going back to God so that his kingdom can be furthered, because I don't want anyone left behind. I want everyone to have that chance, that opportunity to know Jesus Christ, to give Him that chance, to know His love and His hope. This is what Paul was doing. He worked to support his ministry. So I encourage you, I challenge you, if you're not testing God in this, test Him. And I don't care if you give to this church, but give to a church. Some of you are probably thinking, why would you say give to another church? But I just want you to test Him. Trust Him with this, that where the world holds on to money so tightly, and says this, you have to make it for yourself. I'm telling you, God will bless it. So if you don't want to give this church, give to another church. Test him in this. So I'm going to challenge you in that. I'm going to leave that alone. Now, if we go on to verses 36 through 38 in Acts 20, it says, when Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship. Here we see fellowship again. They humbled themselves. They knelt down before God and they prayed with each other. I bet you they were praying for Paul that he would be blessed. I bet that Paul was praying for them that they would go out and serve and reach people and God would use them and bless them. In conclusion, we need to put God first. We need to have fellowship and build relationships with each other. Serve God. We need to trust him with our finances. We need to serve him out in our communities, wherever God has called you. And if you don't know where he's calling you, pray. And if he lays something on your heart, get with me. We'll pray about it together. We'll get started. So that we can fulfill Jesus' mission to share the gospel to the ends of the earth, to be his witnesses, so that we can hear the words, well done, good and faithful servant, when we see our Creator face to face. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your words today, Lord. I pray that we would take your words, Lord, that I pray that everyone would know that these are not my words, that I didn't just make these up, Lord, that you spoke through me today, that these are from you so that we can come face to face with you, so that we can learn more about you and how we can reach people for Jesus. So, Lord, I pray that each one of us, Lord, if they don't have a calling upon their life, I pray that you would just lay it on their hearts. That you would give them strength and courage to fulfill this calling. That, Lord, if they're not trusting you with every aspect of their lives, finances, health, serving, calling, if we're not trusting with everything in our life, Lord, I pray that we would open up that and that we would trust you. Lord, I pray that each person here would seek you daily, come face to face with you, and you would just reveal your character and your love to them. I pray that every ounce of money that is given to this church, Lord, goes to what you want it to go to, the outreach that you want it to go to, and to reach the people that you are going to send us. I pray the name of Jesus over each person here, Lord, that you would give them strength, courage, knowledge, and wisdom to go out and share you, to be your witnesses. Lord, I pray that we would focus on seeking you, putting you first, and I pray that we would grow closer to each other and to you, that we would lean on each other, encourage each other. I pray this in Jesus' name, and I ask your will be done. Amen. May God keep you and watch over you this week and fellowship with each other on the way out.